Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, even perhaps good evening to you wherever you are in the world. We are so excited to have you join us for Inside the Admissions Committee. My name is Jessica Brown, and I'm a member of the Admissions Committee here at Duke, and we're really wanting to just have a really great opportunity to share some helpful information with you about the admissions process. This is what we're going to do today. It's an instance called Inside the Admissions Committee. And we're going to treat this session a little differently than what we've done in times past. Instead of having just a traditional panel, it's really going to be an intriguing and engaging roundtable conversation with members of the Admissions Committee. We're going to share some incredibly helpful information to help make sure that you can submit a competitive application for admission. So come prepared to take notes, learn some helpful insight, and things that will help you to get ready to hit submit. So without further delay, I'm going to pass it on over to our Associate Dean of Admissions, Sherry Hubert, and let's get started with Inside the Admissions Committee.
Thank you, Jessica, and welcome everyone. As Jessica said, we are so excited that you're joining us today from all around the world. And as you can see, it's live, right? I'm happy to be joined by wonderful colleagues, Mandy McGuire, Lauren Sutherland, Sharon Thompson, and Morgan Griffin. And I'm also really happy to see so many of you investing in yourself through the pursuit of an MBA. I can attest to its ability to truly change the trajectory of your life for the better. And we have a lot of wealth of information to share with you. Our goal today really is to help you provide us with the strongest application for our program so that we really get to know the real you and your unique and unequaled assets. So let's get to it. I'm going to turn to Sharon first.
Okay.
And Sharon, I think one of the great things about our program is we provide so much flexibility when it comes to interviews. And so I was wondering if you could share with the audience some of the either, how do we think about the interviews, what's important for them to keep in mind, and perhaps maybe some misperceptions around the interview as well.
Yeah, thank you, Sherry. I enjoy speaking about the interviews, and I totally agree. I love the flexibility that we offer to our students. But first, I'd like the students to kind of keep in mind that the interview is really designed to allow us to get to know more about you. You know, beyond your application, we want to help you bring your candidacy to life. So think as you're preparing for the interview, think about that. You have your written application, but now what can you share during your interview that can bring your application to life? We want to learn more about your goals, your interest, your desire to pursue an MBA, and your desire to study at Fuqua. All of those things are really important to us. We offer flexibility in terms of two options. There are two methods where you have an opportunity to interview. One is during what we call our open interview season, and that's where you, as the applicant, get a chance to self-initiate your interview, right? We do ask that you start an application, so you have to start an application, go through our application to schedule, start an application. You don't have to submit. It's not required to submit, but
ultimately,
just
we want you to submit, though.
Yes. Absolutely,
That is the
absolutely.
goal.
Yes. My other colleagues will walk you through that process and how to submit. So there's the self-initiated. So that's during the open interview. And that really is if you're ready, you've done your research, you feel like this is a really good time, take advantage of that open interview period. Really, it's really there for your flexibility. But if you decide this is not a good time for me, I'm not ready to interview, we start our open interview season in late August through early October. So if you want to spend more time on your application now and focus on your interview later, that's fine. We also will be extending interview invitations by round. So by each application round, you'll have a chance to interview again. So I think, and regardless of how you interview or when you decide to interview, whether it's an open season or by interview by invitation, it doesn't matter to us, right? We want you to really select the format that really works best for you.
Another thing I wanted you to touch on is how, because I think our who interviews you is
Yes.
pretty unique to our program.
Yeah. We love, so if you think about the interview, it is an opportunity for us to get more information about you, but it's also your opportunity to interview us and get more information. And so who better to hear from than our second-year MBA students who are in your shoes? They've gone through this process. So your interviews will be conducted by either a second-year MBA student that we have selected. They're there are admissions fellows or an alum in your area. So another thing about the interview that I think is really important to know who will be conducting the interview, and also the format. So we give you the flexibility and the option to either interview in person or virtual. So if you come to Durham and come to campus, you'll have the opportunity to interview in person with one of our admissions fellows, or that may not work for you and you may decide, I want to interview in my local area, internationally, and you'll be interviewing with an alum. And potentially, if you select a virtual interview, again, an alumnus or an admissions fellow. So again, regardless of when you interview, where you interview, and with who you interview, it doesn't matter. We don't have a particular preference either way. So it's really up to you, and that's what we like. We like to give you that option and that flexibility.
Oh, nice.
So the other thing, if I may share, some other things I love to share about the interview is the importance of being prepared, right? So regardless of when you decide to come for the interview, make sure you're ready to share very authentic responses in terms of why you want an MBA, why you want an MBA from Fuqua, and that's just really how will you contribute and give back to our community. I think those are all really good things that you may write about that in your application, but it's great when you can sit down in a 45-minute conversation and bring those aspects of your application to life. Mm-hmm. So it is a conversation, so just know we're really excited and look forward to getting to know our applicants through that conversation.
Yeah, and I think it's important to know that the only thing that they will have is your resume, right? So
exactly.
It really is your opportunity to bring out what you want them to know about, because otherwise they may not.
Yeah, and another good thing about the resume is that that is the only one thing they will have. And so be familiar with what you put on your resume. Everything is fair game from the resume. So be familiar with all of the accomplishments that you've listed. If you've listed that you have special interests in different areas, be able to speak about that. The fellows, again, this is their fellows and our alums, use this as an opportunity to really get to know you beyond that written application. So bring all of those examples. And I think if you bring great teamwork, leadership examples, and you're able to speak about your readiness to pursue an MBA and pursue it at Fuqua, you're going to do great in the interview.
Right. Well, actually, you're talking about readiness is a great segue to the next area that I feel like people really have lots of questions about. And that is, you know, what's the best time for me to pursue my MBA? I know for me it was 5 years, but for some folks they may not want to wait that long. For others, they may have more than that in terms of years of experience. So Morgan, maybe could you share with us in the audience, how should one think about the timing of in which they are pursuing their MBA, and how we think about that in terms of the admissions committee?
Yeah, I think so many people, they look at our class profile and they're like, okay, I have to hit that exact mark that's in the class profile. And I always have to remind people, there's so much variance on either side of that. It's an average. Take a look at it and then move along. But I think so often when people are sitting in their careers, they're thinking, how do I get to that next step? I'm looking at this person. I would like to move into their role. What do I need? A lot of times they say, I'm missing those leadership skills that you do get in an MBA program. And sometimes you might have that realization that you've hit that ceiling at 2 years, at 5 years, 7 years, 8 years, and so on. And so I think so often what we're really looking for is not the actual number of years of work experience. So often you'll hear us in any presentation we do or conversation, your resume should highlight the impact you've had in your career. And a lot of people can have tremendous impact in a year or two. Mm-hmm. Maybe they were doing an internship before taking that role or working part-time. Maybe they've been working in a startup and have had kind of different experiences than somebody else. So sometimes you can have really, really great impact in a year or two, and that's great. For some people, maybe they've taken a different route, or maybe they were moving up, and so they have a little bit more experience. I often look at our military veterans. A lot of times they have 5, 6, 7 years of work experience. They've been serving our country, and we thank them so much for their service, but they might be a little bit more higher than that 5-year mark. People that are in the Peace Corps transitioning out. Sometimes you've been in a career, you realized it wasn't your thing, and you made a change, and so you need to be in there a little bit longer. I think the pandemic, too, a lot of people kind of put their plans on hold to do certain things, so maybe they're staying in their positions longer. So really, when you're looking at your work experience, the resume, you're talking about how important that is in the interview, don't think of what have I done in my daily role, have I hit that 5-year mark, it's what has your impact been? I want you to humbly brag in your resume of the wonderful things you've done in your career, no matter how many years of experience you have. That's what's so great about it.
That's beautifully said. Humble brag.
Humbly brag.
Right. I like that.
But, you know, we don't know. So if you don't tell us, we're not going to know. So tell us of those achievements. Highlight that. Mm-hmm. Don't list out your daily activities.
And I feel like over the last few years, we've had more applicants on both ends of the range that we publish and advertise. And the best thing to do if you're on the outskirts of the range or beyond the range, either way, is to talk about it in some other area of your application, just so that we aren't left questioning why this is the right time for you. You can address it in the interview or in some of the other components we're going to talk about later.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, sticking on the theme of experience, we also asked for, you know, one letter of recommendation, kind of the third party perspective. Can you talk about how should people prepare their interviewer or their recommender? How should they think about who to select for their recommender? And especially those individuals who might come from either a family business, maybe they're a business owner, they started their own company, or perhaps, I hear this a lot, you know, I've only been in my role for 1 or 2 years. I'm not comfortable with that person. So talk to us, generally speaking, about the recommendations.
Yeah. I feel like you might get to the letter of recommendation section and be like, cool, I just have to put someone's name down. That's the easiest section to get done. And really, like an interview, like anything else, it does take a lot of prep. So I always think of, we'd like to see your manager or supervisor. Take time, whoever your recommender is, and I'll get to that in a second, take time to meet with them. This is a great opportunity to ask them, would you be willing to write me a positive letter of recommendation? But sit down for coffee during a one-on-one meeting, any type of conversation, and kind of talk with them about why are you wanting to pursue an MBA? You certainly cannot write the letter of recommendation. We hope that you would write yourself a great letter of recommendation, but you cannot write it. But you can certainly talk to your interviewer and kind of help paint the story of, this has been my career, these are the things I'm excited about, these are the things I want to do. And that will kind of trigger some memories in their mind. So I think do take time to sit down with your recommender and talk with them and talk through, why are you wanting to go to business school? So often we get so many questions of, well, I have this unique situation, like the ones you laid out, and that's completely fine. We do want you to select a recommender that you feel like is going to highlight your amazing abilities in the workplace. So if you are part of a family business, we would hope your family write a letter of recommendation that's supportive of you, but maybe it's better to ask a client. Or if you have a new manager or you haven't told your manager, maybe a previous manager or colleague. There's so many scenarios where that could be true, especially if you own your own company. You can't write that, ask a client. Certainly, if you have any questions, always ask any of us. We can always kind of guide you through that. I think the biggest thing is just explain your choice of recommender if it's not your manager or supervisor, because we could sit there and say, well, what happened here? What's going on? So I think if there's ever a question, just explain it. We usually look at that and we say, hey, that makes sense, and we move on. But again, it might be as simple as putting someone's name in. It sends them that common letter. Spend time and prep them before you input their name into that field.
Yeah, very, very good advice. And that's a great use of the optional essay, which we'll talk about a little bit later as well. The clarification if it is someone that isn't, you know, the usual type of recommender.
I'll just mention quickly, Morgan, you said, you know, you're going to be sending them the common letter of recommendation, right?
Yes.
That's what they're going to be receiving. So you have the opportunity now, or applicants do, to say, hey, let me go see what those questions are. So the person I pick, are they going to be able to answer this about me?
Exactly.
Many times we see a mistake that someone says, oh, but I had this professor 5 years ago that really loved me. They loved my project I did. But the challenge with that is they cannot answer a lot of those sort of teamwork, team dynamic, you know, what types of responsibilities you've taken on during, you know, your workplace. So it's really important to go ahead and check those questions out and then make sure that you are selecting the best fit person to be able to answer that. Because for some of us, I would say maybe an average recommendation, but from a good fit recommender is actually better than if you choose someone who can't answer all the questions and says no basis for judgment. That's always really hard for us to take that recommendation and go anywhere with it. So make sure you choose someone who can, I think that'd be a
that's great advice. That is great.
Answer those questions from, you know, those topics that you can already see on the comment application.
Yeah, that's a new piece of advice
great.
I haven't heard, so that's great.
I never would have thought of that. So I'm going to start using that now. That is great.
Excellent.
Great advice.
It's helpful for them to have an insight into our, like, how we're analyzing that or evaluating that, you know, when we do see that, like, I can't comment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so excellent. Thank you, mm-hmm. Mandy.
Sure.
We're going to shift a little bit to standardized tests, and there's so much that has been changing in the landscape of standardized mm-hmm. testing, from new versions to test optional to test waivers, like everything in between. You know, I'm going to ask you, Lauren, kind of share our philosophy around mm-hmm. standardized tests, the types of tests we choose to accept, how we think about that, and then, you know, and then we'll go on from that to talk more generally around the academic experience. But I think the standardized test is an important one to really focus on.
Absolutely. I always get this topic whenever we're having discussions, and I actually enjoy it. And I know it's not an area of the application that most applicants enjoy preparing for, but at Fuqua, it is required to submit one of the standardized tests that we accept, which are the GRE, the GMAT, and the executive assessment. And I hope that perhaps this year there will be even less anxiety around that because there are newer versions mm-hmm. coming out of both the GRE and the GMAT. So there's a lot of ways that you as an applicant will be able to tell us how you are best prepared academically for the MBA. That's really the root of why we still accept standardized tests, is it's something that we can see from every applicant who applies to Fuqua as one mark of their academic readiness. I know we've started to get questions already of how are you going to compare the GMAT to the GMAT Focus to the executive assessment, and we aren't going to be comparing apples to oranges to bananas. That's not really helpful to us. What we are going to compare is how you are doing on whatever tests you decide to submit to us. So whether that is the current GRE, the GRE that will launch in a few weeks, and the executive assessment, we'll take whichever one is best for you, but we do get to see your trajectory as you've been preparing, taking, perhaps retaking these tests. Submit all of the scores to us. We only will see the ones that you tell us about, and we love seeing grit and perseverance mm-hmm. through that. And I also will give just one maybe note of peace to applicants that we as an admissions committee have encountered this before. So the executive assessment was a new test a few years ago that we were able to incorporate mid-cycle into our evaluation process, and it really helped some applicants show another side of their readiness that they weren't able to get at through the GMAT or the GRE. So even with these new additions that are launching really soon, know that the admissions committee has been there before and is really excited to see mm-hmm. how this will benefit applicants, no matter which test you decide to submit to us.
Yeah, yeah. And I think people, it's really important to underscore that these tests, they help us understand the aptitude and readiness, but it doesn't determine your success mm-hmm. right in the program.
Right.
And again, we value that, I think in particular at Fuqua. So talk a little bit about, more generally speaking, mm-hmm. kind of academic preparation, what we look for in that kind of broader sense of readiness.
Yeah.
Through their entire academic history, not just the one test.
Right. So that standardized test is one point, one data point, one piece of information in time on your academic profile. We're also going to take a look at your performance in undergrad and how you challenged yourself in the courses that you took. So mm-hmm. we will pour into your transcripts to see what the trajectory looked like for you in undergraduate. And we know sometimes that is not always linear and it can be a little bit bumpy. So that's a great thing to tell us about in the optional statement. But know that we're looking at who you were as a student in the past, but also for your ability to succeed in the future. And none of these data points that we're talking about in academics or really at any point in this application cycle are indicative alone. They're really a part of the whole that shows us that you're going to be successful at Fuqua. And if one part of your academic profile isn't as strong as the other, that's okay. That's why we have multiple data points to look at. But if you know that you had a difficult time in undergraduate, perhaps focus a little bit more on the piece you can control now, which is the standardized test, and figuring out which test is right for you. But know that we're looking at undergraduate degrees if you have a graduate degree, you should tell us about it, because again, the more data points, the better we can figure out your fit for Fuqua. But we aren't scoring a graduate degree because not every applicant has that. But every applicant will have standardized test, a GPA, and an undergraduate degree.
Mm-hmm. So what can they do if they want to shore up around their GPA, because there's not anything you can do about your GPA at this point, mm-hmm. and they don't do as well as they had hoped on their standardized test. What else? What are the other things that you've seen people submit or share mm-hmm. to demonstrate academic readiness?
Yeah, can I get the table to, I know MBAMath.com is something we require of admitted students, and we see it frequently mm-hmm. as an update to academics or as a waitlist update if students are waitlisted throughout the process. But what are some of the other things that you like to see?
Well, I think even MBA Math is great. As a communications political science major, I can appreciate that sometimes quant is not my strong suit, and that is okay, and we need those poets and quants kind of in our mm-hmm. class. So I think MBA Math can also be really great, not only for GPA, but even just if you wanted to say, I came from that liberal arts major, that I can show that I'm willing to learn how to do quant work and get up to speed and do well in that mm-hmm. class and be self-initiated. You talked about being like a self-starter and grit. Like, that's a great way to just show, like, hey, I'm willing to learn this and take mm-hmm. the steps needed.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say also, if time will permit, I think mm-hmm. taking some quantitative courses, and as long as they are, you know, from an accredited institution, we will look at that and take mm-hmm. that into consideration. Mm-hmm. Also, we offer MBA Math, so a week before you start the program. That's another, mm-hmm. as you're thinking about as you get closer to enrolling. See, I'm already moving you forward to, like, getting here and being,
yes.
you're going to submit. But just in terms of preparation, I think all of this is not just for you to help you in the application process, but also to prepare you for once you get to business school. So think of those things that not just I want to get admitted, but also what will help me in the long term when I am making that transition to business school.
We also have the math camp, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, math review.
Math review, yes. Exactly. And, you know, I took a statistics course at a university, continuing ed type of university, so you can do that. You can do online courses. There's a number of very mm-hmm. short online types of courses that are very quantitative. So, you know, there are a number of ways. We also look at your work experience, right? Mm-hmm. So if you don't have any of the things that we just suggested, but you can demonstrate through the professional work, the projects, they may be quantitative, they may be analytical, you know, enable you to be using data in some form or fashion. Talk about all of that information. Mm-hmm. All of that's mm-hmm. fair game, and it gives us additional context around, okay, they're numerate, they can understand, they're not scared by the numbers, that kind of thing. And I was a French major. Right? And so it's definitely doable.
Mm-hmm. And I think, too, you know, especially people right now, they're sitting here, they're taking all these notes and, like, I have to do all this stuff. Let's say you're submitting in an earlier round and you're trying to get your test score done and your resume. Even after you submit, you can always send us updates. Yeah, so if you started MBA Math now, don't think you have to complete mm-hmm. that. If you're looking to apply early action right now and you're panicking, you have time. You can always send us updated test scores, MBA Math transcripts, Coursera, updates like that. So don't feel like you have to cram it all in and getting it done before you submit. We do accept updates as well throughout the process.
That's right. Good reminder. All righty. So we've gotten through the hard stuff, right? Now we're going through the really hard stuff. But it should be the fun stuff too, right? To me, this is one of the funner aspects of the experience and the application process, and that's essays, right? And it's really, I feel like it's the applicant's that and maybe interviews really opportunity to allow us to see and hear from them in their own voice, be it the written word or oral, and really share with us their unique and unequaled assets. And we talk a lot internally, we've coined the term authentic individuality. What is that? What does the acronym say for it? You guys get that, AI, right? But we want to see your authentic individuality. And so, Mandy, talk a little bit about how our essays allow for that. If our audience uses them in the right way and they're vulnerable enough to really show us who they are and their lived experience. Can you talk a little bit about our essays?
Absolutely. And as you all can probably imagine, for me, the essays are the most exciting part of the application. Until we have an interview piece, mm-hmm. the essays are that part that your application kind of jumps. You jump off the paper, right? You come to life. And so the essays are incredibly exciting for us to read. Probably for most team members in admissions, it's the most exciting part of the application to look at. We get to really know the applicants. We get to know know what you're excited about, what you're passionate about, more about your background. So I do think our essays do lend themselves to getting that more authentic piece of yourself as an applicant. So, you know, the one that really stands out to most people as different from other maybe peer business schools, other applications you're considering, is the 25 things about yourself essay. Mm-hmm. We are truly looking for you to share those 25 things about yourself that help us understand you, your genuine self, what you'd be bringing to our community, how you are going to, you know, impact our community. What are the things you enjoy? These could be things from your childhood. They could be things about your partner, your pet, things you enjoy doing on the weekend, goals you have for the future, trips you've taken, really any variety and any order you want to put them in, truly. But this is kind of a different way of going about a personal statement. It's really a way to get to know you on that genuine level, for you to find those kind of quirky, funny, maybe more touching and serious things, like whatever you want to share. If you're funny, be funny. If you're more serious, that's great too. It's just more about being genuine. And I think most of us at this table have read enough that we can kind of figure that out from the first few facts about someone, right? Like, is this really what they're bringing to the table? Is this, you know, truly who they are? And so that's exciting for us. I think one thing sometimes folks miss when they think about the authentic and showing themselves in that essay is that they focus too much on, you know, maybe how many times they've done something, or that they've taken, you know, they've been to 35 countries, or, you know, 49 states, and they're getting to that last one. But they'll say, you know, I've been to 49 states, period. And that's it. And for us, that's a very quantitative fact versus helping us understand maybe how something has impacted you. So usually my tip on that is to say things like, okay, well, hey, I did this trip to North Dakota one time, and, you know, something happened there. And then we get sort of this impact of you from that one trip versus just saying, hey, I like to travel and I've been to 49 states. Mm-hmm. Because as I think all of us can imagine, most MBA students love to travel. So we see these facts a lot. So think about something that can really make you stand out as an applicant. That's usually sort of my best tip there. But that's kind of the first piece, the authentic you in that 25 things about yourself essay. The second long essay, which is more focused on sort of your authentic self at Fuqua. Mm-hmm. So we are asking, you know, with every applicant, you are supposed to tell us, you know, three things or three ways that you're going to be impactful at Fuqua. But that helps us tell your story, right? Your story that you've shown through us, your goals, your backgrounds, then how you would be impactful here. But it also shows that you've done your homework on Fuqua. Mm-hmm. We want to see that you know that not only you want an MBA, but you want an MBA here at Fuqua. That is what we are truly looking for. And that you see that fit for yourself, because it is a two-way street. And that's super important for us to get to know. So those are kind of the main ways we could, I mean, I think any of us could talk about essays for an hour. And the, like, ones that have been great examples or different things. But we, you know, essays are really fun for us to read. Again, it's just for us to get to know you. And those ones who share their authentic selves, I can guarantee you when they get to campus, we see them like, oh, that's the person who did that. That's the person who did that. I will see them as the lead of the consulting club. Yeah, those are the things we see, and it's super enjoyable for us to get to know applicants that way.
And I think that second essay is really important, because it is such a student-driven community here. Mm-hmm. And so it really gives us insight into how will you contribute, mm-hmm. right, once you get here. It's not just about what you're gonna learn and gain. Right. That's pretty table stakes. It's really about what are you going to leave for others and your classmates mm-hmm. along the journey, right? So I love both of those essays. I'm gonna ask you to talk a little bit about another aspect of our, of what we look for that I think is really unique to us, because it's so much, there's a lot of emphasis, I think, put onto it, and it's leadership and involvement. And I know a lot of schools look for that, but I really think we really look for it and hear about it. And it shows up in a lot of different ways, because I talked about the fact that it's student-driven, right? Mm-hmm. So talk about, like, what do we mean by leadership and involvement? We call it L&I internally, but what do we mean by leadership and involvement? And what are the vast types of things that could go into that area?
Sure. And yeah, we do reserve, I'm not sure if everyone does, but here at Fuqua we reserve an entire section of the application to leadership and involvement. For us, we truly want to get to know your passions. What do you enjoy doing outside of work? How are you making an impact? Because that's gonna hopefully lead to what you would do if you came to Fuqua. That's what we are hoping to see. You know, the essay I just discussed is what you hope to do at Fuqua. Now we wanna learn what you've done that would hopefully lead up to that. So the leadership and involvement section gives someone the option, or the gateway sort of to provide for us, not just a title of something they've been involved with, but to then show, okay, how many years have you been involved with this organization? Have you taken on leadership roles with them? time. Tell us a little bit. It gives you some open space to tell about the organization. There are certain ones that we are very familiar with already, but there are many ways that people are involved that we're not already familiar. So on the flip side, unfortunately, many times we see people leave that leadership and involvement section blank. I would say that's the biggest pitfall, and surprisingly that people leave something blank, but it is probably the most common section that is left maybe underused or not used at all. And so folks will say something along the lines of, see resume, and want us to refer back to the resume. But that doesn't cover all the questions we're asking you in that leadership and involvement section, right? To gain more insight into your impact. And some people, again, just leave it blank. And so then we're kind of trying to give folks the benefit of the doubt, going back to their resume, going to other pieces, and hoping to find something that shares what these folks are interested in. So, you know, the biggest tip is to think about, what are the ways that I'm involved currently, but also in the past? We're happy to take into account what people have done at undergrad. These are going to be things that could possibly look like, you know, something all the way up to like a board membership, a board role. It could be something that is local to your community that you just love volunteering at maybe an animal shelter every weekend. Maybe you have started working as, you know, in other community organizations with startups in your area or something of that nature. Maybe you were president of a club in undergrad or played an intramural sport or a varsity sport, which we all know it takes a lot of time in undergrad. So help us understand how you've spent that time and then how we can see that like long term or maybe even a new commitment as well, and we can understand what you are passionate about. So we will take all those into account. I will say the one question we get the most a lot of times are for people who are either in a job that travels a ton, maybe like some of our consultants or maybe also our military folks where it is a true lifestyle, right? And I think those are folks who say, but I don't know what to put on there. I don't live in one place long enough to like make an impact on that community. And so for us, we typically are going to say, hey, think about those things though that aren't part of your job role. Okay. Are you part of an employee resource group? Do you plan, maybe it's one day a year, but do you help with the service day? So these are all things we are happy to take into account. And you know, if you don't have that traditional leadership and involvement, as some people may think about it.
Perfect, perfect. The only thing I will add, and I know we're running out of time, is we have a new section that everyone should know about. It's called the optional section. It's under the family background, personal background, and it asks a couple of yes-no questions, but it does leave an open field of no more than 200 words to share anything else about your lived experience that perhaps you haven't had an opportunity to share in any other aspect of the application process. And I would say so that people know to differentiate this optional kind of statement or this optional open field from the optional essay, think about this optional open field as something that's new and substantive, right? It could be a particular 25 random fact that you really want to expound upon, and you want to talk about how your lived experience, your family background, your upbringing, it could be financial or otherwise, has really impacted and shaped who you are and shaped how you will show up in our community. So it's all about how that lived experience brings, gives you grit, determination, aspiration, things like that, that will benefit our community. That's that, that 200 word, and it doesn't have to be 200 words, right? But it should be kind of a substantive. Differentiate it from the optional statement, as Oren mentioned, or optional essay, as many of you know about. That's more of a clarification. That's when you use, you know, the clarification of the kind of recommender you decided to use that might have been different from what our instructions said, as Morgan had mentioned, right? So it's a clarification on an aspect of your application that might be missing, a gap you that's different than the instructions. That's a perfect use of that. And it could be bullets. It could be one word. It could be phrases, right? And so it doesn't have to be a full kind of essay. So think about it in that way. We could go on and on. I want to thank my panelists. This has been a wonderful conversation. I've learned something new. I know that we have wonderful students waiting to meet you and talk to you at the next session. So we encourage you to stay tuned. I just want to say, in along with all of us, just thank you for being here. Thank you for investing in yourself. Best of luck, and we look forward to seeing you and your application this fall. Good luck, and I'm going to turn it over to Jessica now.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back. Thank you again for joining us for the first portion of this event, and I do hope that the information shared by my colleagues in the admissions office was incredibly helpful for you. I enjoy working with them. They are fantastic. And from what I could hear a little bit, they were giving you some really good information. So I do hope that you took really good notes for that portion. I told you all at the beginning that this was going to be something a little different. And for the first time, we're bringing in student panelists, current students, to share their insight and hopefully give you some helpful information that'll help you with crafting different components of your application as well. They are very familiar with how you're feeling right now. They were in your shoes not too long ago. And so I thought it'd be helpful to bring them into the conversation to help give you information on what they did and to help craft their applications, whether it's the essays or how they approach their recommender. There's a wealth of information that I thought would be helpful for them to share with you as well. And so I'm excited to have four fantastic students join today. So I'm going to start with Stephanie and ask you to give an introduction of yourself. All of our panelists will give you a little bit of information about who they are and their backgrounds. And then I'm going to ask them a couple of questions based upon some of the things that you've put in the chat, as well as other things I think will be helpful for you to know so that you can get started with putting the final touches on your application. So Stephanie, if you don't mind, can you start us off?
Hi, everyone. My name is Stephanie Blair. I'm originally from Chester, New Jersey. Prior to Fuqua, I was a senior consultant in Deloitte's advisory practice, specifically within internal audit and assurance. And post-MBA, I will be joining Deloitte's consulting practice for full-time.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Louis Wu. I'm from Brooklyn, New York, originally. Prior to Fuqua, I worked in the higher ed and education space. Post-MBA, I'm looking to recruit into either an ed tech company or somewhere in the education and knowledge sector in consulting. I'm currently completing my internship this summer at IBM Finance, where I work in the software pricing strategy group. And in Fuqua, some of the involvement and clubs I'm involved in is I'm part of the MBA, which is the student cabinet position. I'm a co-fellow. I'm an admissions fellow here, and I'm also involved in FCCP.
Hey, guys. I'm Fred Stillman. I'm also from New York City. Prior to Fuqua, I worked in the sports industry, mostly representing players on endorsement and marketing contracts. Post-Fuqua, looking to transition into the financial sector. My current summer internship, I've been at FTI Consulting in their financial consulting group. And at Fuqua, like Louis, I'm also a Cole Fellow and admissions fellow.
Hi, everyone. My name's Nikhil Srikumar. I'm from Sydney, Australia. Prior to Fuqua, I was working in sports, consulting, ESG investments, and also in the electric vehicle space. Currently, I'm doing my internship at Amazon Robotics. And post-MBA, I'm trying to recruit into technology or the sustainability space. At Fuqua, I'm a tech cabinet member, an admissions fellow, and a career fellow as well.
Awesome. Thank you all again so much for your introductions. I literally just got back on Friday from a 5-country tour throughout Southeast Asia and also went up to Korea and Japan to host different events and information sessions and coffee chats with prospective candidates. And one of the first questions I get is, can you explain Team Fuqua and exactly what Team Fuqua means and how can I understand that? And so I'm not asking you to tell us like what Team Fuqua means to us right now. I'm sure you get that question quite often, but more so, how did you determine that Fuqua is a place for you specifically? How did you connect with our community during the application process? Was it through conversations with current students or a campus visit or a virtual information session? How did you find your way through navigating through all the information that's provided to allow you to be able to establish an authentic connection there? And Stephanie, I'll start with you.
Yeah, so I think the first step I really took was going online on the Fuqua page and really signing up for all the admissions events and information sessions. We were applying during COVID, so a lot of those were virtual, but definitely would take advantage of any in-person opportunities as well. And the second step I took was to go on the student ambassador page. And I think a lot of us on this panel are student ambassadors, so feel free to go on that page and reach out to us for any questions. But just connecting with students that had either similar backgrounds as me career-wise or potential interests if I were to join the Fuqua community, such as certain clubs I was interested in, and really connecting with them and understanding, you know, what their experience in those clubs were like or certain like hands-on learning opportunities they were involved in. And I think the third part I did was I connected with alumni, specifically alumni in my organization. I didn't know any of them, but I would reach out and say, hey, I'm interested in applying to Fuqua. Would love to schedule a coffee chat with you. Sometimes they would offer to look at my essays. So if you don't have anybody in your organization, I would say you could really reach out to anybody in the Fuqua community, whether it's current students or alumni. Everyone is extremely willing to, you know, speak with you or connect you with other people that they know.
Awesome. Nikhil, I'm going to ask you to contribute as well. As an international student, did you help? What was your approach? Did you do anything different from Stephanie? Or I could just imagine with the time difference, it might have been a challenge to attend some of the virtual information sessions. So how did you approach that process?
Challenge is definitely an understatement. For me, adding to Steph's point as well, I think for me, coming from Australia, one of the struggles was finding someone who's from Australia as well in schools in the US. So in that case, the community here was really helpful because even if they're not student ambassadors, they were willing to get me in touch with students who are from this area. So that was one way there was an organic connection being met as well. On top of that, as Steph mentioned, I was able to connect with Fuqua alumni who are from Australia as well, who've been to this. And I think it's during the COVID time, there was a lot of virtual sessions that kind of helped me a lot more than having in person. Because Australia had pretty strict rules. So what I could do is after work, log into different sessions and get all the information I needed, try to set up my emails that connect with a lot of the Fuqua folks here. I think that was something that really helped me. And even with the time zone, a lot of the people are actually quite accommodating. They were willing to come early morning as well, which is still midnight for me, but it was perfect in that way. So they're really accommodating in that sense as well.
Fantastic. Lou or Fred, anything else you want to add to that?
I think, both Nikhil and Steph had great points. Definitely connect to the admissions, representatives on the website. I know for me, I looked up people who were working in my background, specifically in the higher ed and education space. I think I was super invaluable. It was actually through one of those connections that I got one of my first virtual calls with Christopher. We graduated 2 years ago, and we just connected. We're both from New York City. We both came from very similar professional backgrounds. And then as we spoke more and more, we got to know that we also came from similar personal upbringings and backgrounds. And he actually connected me then with someone from the admissions team itself. So that's the one thing I really want to add. I think in addition to all of the amazing current year students, first year students and second year students at USP, definitely don't underestimate, how good a connection speaking with the admissions, staff is, not just Jessica here, but just like everyone on admissions as a whole, they provide a wealth of resources and can really guide you on how you should approach not just your application, but, your views on Fuqua, what you can learn, what to kind of tap into. So I highly, highly recommend, keep in touch, don't be a stranger, always, touch base and update admissions. They love to hear back from everyone. And I really enjoy that part of my process.
I always tell prospective candidates, if you could just get connected to one student, that gets you connected to almost everybody. If you have a question about a particular industry, or if you're wanting to try and connect to someone who's from your hometown or your undergraduate school, or it just has a similar interest, it just takes knowing someone like Fred, who helped to plan our admitted student weekend, who clearly knows tons of his classmates, who will say, oh yeah, I can connect you to this person. And then that person can connect you to someone else. And that's really how you start to get deeper into our community and to really know and understand who we are. When you have the opportunity to kind of go beyond just the surface level of the website and have those intentional conversations, which I think are fantastic and really provides a lot of really good insight. And once you do that, then that helps you to kind of figure out where you are in the process and also when you might want to submit your application. So can you all talk a little bit about that as well? And maybe Stephanie, and kind of going in the order of your introductions, tell us what round you applied in and what helped you to decide that that was the ground that was good for you, whether it was based upon work assignments or life. How did you figure out what would be the best time for you to submit your application?
Yeah, so I decided to apply round one. I think my situation was a little unique because I decided to take a full year to really prep and take the GREs. Just knowing myself historically, I am not the strongest standardized test taker. So I really wanted to make sure I focus on that part of my application. So by the time it came to apply, I was ready to go for round one. I decided not to do early decision just because I was still trying to take the GRE for the second time and it was cutting it close. So for me, round one worked really well, but I would say just make sure, you know, you're choosing the round that works best for you and where you're going to be able to put your best self forward in the application itself.
Yeah, so for me, I applied EA early round. And for me, my situation is unique. So I applied to Fuqua actually the previous cycle in the last round. It was round three at the time. And I did not get in initially, but I got a lot of feedback, not just from admissions, but also, you know, I looked inward and was introspective about some areas I felt like I needed to improve. And I knew, like, right then and there, I wanted to go to Fuqua. I connected with all the folks I wanted to connect with. I got a really good vibe from not just everyone I've spoken to, but everyone that had been, you know, reaching out in general, just like from all the other like current applicants. Everyone got a very good positive feeling about Fuqua, and I knew that this was a scoop for me. So I applied earlier, you know, action. It's not going to be the same for everyone. Obviously, I think you should apply, and admissions and pretty much anyone will tell you, whenever you feel ready, you know, put your best foot forward. Don't rush anything. Be sure that you come in with, you know, the right mindset in place. You definitely want to present your best self. And I think for me, I knew going into the summer, EA made the most sense because I was prepared from the year before. So that's when I applied.
Yeah, so I took a bit of a different path than Stephanie and Lewis. I applied round two, or what was round two, that sort of January 5th, January 10th deadline. I sort of didn't actually really decide that I was going to fully go for my MBA until like July, the summer before. So I wouldn't recommend exactly following that path, because it was then basically a 6-month sprint where all I was focusing on was, you know, taking the GRE, writing the essays, all of that. But for me, it was just, that was when I knew I could put, as everyone said, you know, kind of put my best foot forward and have my application material from recommenders to all the essays in its sort of best form. So I applied round two.
I applied similar to in EA as well, like early action. But in my case, it was, I've been preparing for a year before that because COVID, Australia's lockdown. So I had a lot of free time at sitting at home. So I was like, let's start preparing applications. And I wanted to apply as early as possible as well, mainly because I wasn't sure how the visa situation was going to work out, if the rules were going to relax, how the whole move was going to happen, because I had to sort out my house as well before moving here, all our furniture. So that's going to take a fair bit of time. So I made sure I had plenty of time to go through the whole process, but I also wanted to invest a further amount of time in my company, which I was working then. And that's kind of because of the relation I had with them, which was really great and really helped with my application as well. So I just wanted to spend a bit more time with them before I move on to my MBA as well. So that was my reasoning, at least, yeah.
So if you don't take anything else away, like, they all had different approaches to this process, the same fantastic outcome in getting admitted to Fuqua and joining our program and being, you know, great students within our community. So with that being said, like, there is no perfect path. There's no one path that everyone must take. There are many different ways to achieve the ultimate goal of submitting a competitive application and being admissible into our program. And each person's approach was different. They applied in different rounds, and ultimately they decided what timing was going to be best for them, whether it was a year out or 6 months before. Like, you know what works best for you. But I think one key thing that they all also mentioned is really being prepared and being ready to hit submit, presenting your authentic self in the application, regardless as to what round you choose to apply in, but making sure that you're ready. And some people can get ready sooner than others, and then some people need a little bit more time. Ultimately, the path is what you created to be for yourself. And we do want that path to lead you to success. So thank you again for sharing all that information. So now that you've decided what round to apply, there are a couple of components of the application that require some time and effort. Obviously, the test and deciding what test you're going to take and taking that test, whether it was once or twice or taking multiple tests, totally up to the applicant. The one question I get a lot about, though, is how do we approach the essays, in particular, the random 25 things essay? And I have to tell the story of, you know, as an admissions officer, everyone in our office has written the random 25 things essay. So I get it. You're trying to figure out, what do I share? What's too much? What's not enough? What's not enough is a literal random list of things. And you'd be amazed at how many times people submit that with their applications. That's definitely not what we're looking for. But as, you know, current students that have written that essay, talk a little bit about how you approach that process. And did you talk to friends or family members? Like, did you go deep into memories that you had completely forgotten about prior to? How did you decide what to share? And Nikhil, I think I'll start with you because I feel like you're always going last. So let's start with you first. Can you tell us a little bit about how you approach that process, considering you had so much downtime during COVID to kind of, you know, think about what you wanted to share?
Yeah, I think the advantage of having so much downtime is my friends had a lot of downtime as well. So I kept nagging them. So in my case, I really enjoyed writing this essay because it was something like I had to like dig deeper. There's certain aspects I forgot about completely. And I'm like, so what I did is write down, like try to get to at least 30 random facts, which I might find interesting. And then I'll hand it over to my wife and she's like, you know, you missed this. You can write this as well. I'm like, oh, okay. I didn't miss that. Then it becomes 31. And I give it to my friend and they're like, I don't like this. It's not that interesting. So that maybe goes out. So I kept like passing it around and see what's interesting. And there were certain aspects like, one of my friends would come back and say, you know, you missed this. And I'm like, I completely forgot about that. So that was like a process in which I came across this. And I think after sending it to multiple people, you get to know what exactly is you from your perspective, but also someone else's perspective as well. And that's what kind of forms you. So that's what my approach was looking at this essay, at least, yeah.
And Fred, you had a shorter time frame, unless you had already started working on your essays, which I don't think you did. But how did you approach your process? Did you do anything differently?
Yeah, I mean, I guess with that sort of shorter time frame, it wasn't too much different. It's obviously just a little more kind of condensed and sped up. I think the first thing I did when I read that essay question was I kind of immediately just started a Word document where I was just writing. I didn't keep it random, like it wasn't, you know, maybe like some of the other essays you get submitted, but I just sort of wrote down anything that popped into my head. I think, you know, sort of my first rough draft was like, there were 55 facts, you know, listed on it. So kind of don't limit yourself trying to craft, like this has to be 25 perfect things at first, on the first go. Just kind of let my mind wander and wrote down whatever came, whatever popped into my head. Something that was also very helpful for me was asking parents, friends, whatever, not just to look at it, but also like, hey, when you think of me, is there a story that comes to mind, or you know, is there something I've maybe shared with you in the past that you think of or always remember with me, to again kind of help jog my memory some. And then when it came to finally, you know, whittling it down, certainly used friends and things too, but also kind of tried to look more. It was the last essay that I finished for Duke, was the 25 things essay, and just kind of looking at what else I'd written, kind of what were maybe the key themes or, you know, traits, characteristics that I was trying to highlight, and make sure that those also came across in the essay too.
Thank you. Fred, I think you get the award for the most written facts. Did you say 55?
Yeah, at one point, I think it was like 55.
Okay. I definitely have an award for you because, listen, that's a lot of writing. Okay. And so in addition to that, there's one other essay that I think people get caught up on a little bit. And we ask three ways that you want to be engaged and connected within the Fuqua community. And I think by default, it's, oh yes, I want to join the finance club, and then I want to join AWIB, the Association of Women in Business, and then I want to volunteer with Fuqua on board. So Stephanie and Lou, this one is for you. How did you all approach that essay in particular? Did any conversations that you've had with current students or alumni kind of help you to better influence what you included in that essay and the approach to the information that you shared? Lou, let's start with you.
Yeah, of course. So I think obviously, you know, we have Fuqua's iconic 25 random facts essay, which, you know, was my favorite. I have to be honest, it was a blast writing it. But for your involvement with the Duke community, I think, you know, being very intentional with how you plan to like see yourself as not just a student at Fuqua, but a person in the Fuqua community, I think that's very important, right? So what I wrote about and kind of how I approached it was, I reached out to all of the professional clubs that I knew I wanted to be involved in. And instead of just looking at, you know, like what the clubs entail, like for example, the tech club, right? I reached out to tech leadership at the time. So what you can do is you can actually go and search up the current cabinet for all the clubs that you wish to be involved in. And you can actually speak to, obviously, the leadership positions in these clubs. They might be a little busy, especially after this transition back like September, and folks are, you know, getting back in a group of class. But I found that extremely helpful because not only were these second years and these leaders in these communities willing to speak to me, they were willing to speak to me about everything that they've done the past year. You know, the events that were hosted on campus, speakers that came onto campus that were organized by the clubs, folks who volunteered their time, and the level of involvement and dedication that it, you know, took a need to make sure that these clubs are running well. As I'm sure a lot of you might know, Fuqua is a student-driven and student-led, you know, environment. Of course, we get resources and access from faculty and admissions and the Duke overall network as a whole, but it is very student-led. And because I knew that was the case, I really wanted to see how, as a student, I could be involved. So again, I, you know, made sure that I reached out to all of the leadership on the Fuqua website, you know, got their insights and kind of pictured myself being a contributing member and the events that I will be helping plan and just the level of involvement I will be. So again, it seems like almost too straightforward, but speak to and as to many folks as you can in the clubs and both professional affinity that you wish to be involved in. And then I think that will pay dividends.
I think for me, there's really two parts to this essay. One, you have to do some self-reflection on what you want to get out of your time in business school and where you want to be afterwards. And then you have to think about what resources and what opportunities are at Fuqua that will help you get there. So you can almost think of it as like a blueprint, and really being as specific as possible about how you want to spend your 2 years here, because they go by so fast and there's so much that you can get involved in. So thinking about that ahead of time is really beneficial, regardless of whether you're writing an essay about it or not. But I think, you know, what admissions really wants to see is that you put the time and thought into, you know, why Fuqua, and, you know, specifically, how is this going to help you get to where you want to be? So I really thought about that. And then, you know, again, like Lou said, like looking at talking to people with those within those, either whether it was like clubs, whether it was classes I wanted to take, reaching out to professors and, you know, scheduling 10 minutes with them to like talk a little bit about the classes they teach, whether it's a hands-on learning experience, talking to somebody within, you know, that area, whatever it may be, you know, understand what your goals are, how Fuqua is going to help you achieve those, and then learning more about those opportunities and really being as specific as possible in the essays will really help.
So my key takeaways here: intentional and blueprint. Being very intentional with how you connect with current students and alumni to understand their connection to our community and what value add you'll bring, which helps you to also see and help you find your place. And then also just having a strategy behind what you're sharing and why, really, and making sure that is clear as you approach that part of the application. And and to be aware of our time, because we're running over a little bit, I have one more question for our student panelists before I let you go. And that is the interview, right? Lots of questions about the admissions interview. And is it better to interview during the open season or to wait for an invite to interview, which I know Sharon spoke about in great detail in the earlier portion. So not necessarily which interview you chose, but how did you prepare for it? And more than likely, and correct me if I'm wrong, were all of your interviews virtual? Yes. Perfect. Okay. Sounds right about. So tell us a little bit about your approach to the interview process. How did you get ready for that? Did you look up your interviewer on LinkedIn? Did you look at their Facebook page? Did you try and search for them online? Like, how did you get prepared for that? And talk a little bit about your interview experience as well. And Fred, can you start us off with this one?
Sure. Yeah. So I definitely looked up my interviewer, who, you know, second year student. I think more likely than not, that's probably who will be interviewing you. So first piece of advice is don't freak out about it. Don't stress, right? We're trying to, like with the essay process and everything, you want to present, you know, your genuine self and, you know, kind of have those why Fuqua answers, and the more specific, the better. So for the preparation, aside from looking up the interviewer, see if we had any kind of common touch points or things, I think for me, it was really just, again, kind of focusing on the why and why Fuqua in very specific details, and not, you know, less kind of the general, like my broad, you know, career goals and things. Those came into a part, but really how Fuqua and either clubs at Fuqua or certain aspects of the Fuqua community that I've been exposed to played a big part in choosing to apply to Fuqua. So I think kind of, again, keeping it sort of as specific as you can. Don't stress. I thought I bombed my interview. I thought it went terrible, and here I am. So it's clearly, it's not, you know, it's not the end all be all too. I think keep in mind that it's most likely a second year student interviewing you. And it's not investment banking. I'm trying to grill you and cut you with it. It's to learn about you and understand your why and your drive.
Awesome. Thank you. Nikhil, how about you?
In my case, at least in my head, I wanted to make sure it was like a conversation and didn't feel like a constructed two-sided conversation. So I was like, be my genuine self, show what my exact passion is and be myself and not think about the process as a whole, getting into it. Another challenge for me was the timing as well. It was going to be at 3 a.m. So I got to make sure that I'm fresh. Especially because work starts again next morning, right? So I need to be like, sleep early, get up again, but not like 10 minutes before the interview, but like try to prepare myself. So I try to do that 2 days before the interviews as well, so that it kind of becomes a, but other than that, I knew exactly the different points I wanted to touch on based on my career so far, which kind of showed my passion in what I wanted to do going ahead. It wasn't like constructed sentences, but it's like I knew the exact points I wanted to touch. And the second part is try to have a conversation, get to know the other person as well, so that it just feels genuine. Yeah.
Fantastic. Stephanie or Lou?
Yeah. So I want to talk a little bit about more how I prepared. So I think it's no secret that there's a lot of questions out there on the internet for, you know, either interviews that have happened in the past or just some sample questions. So what I did was I compiled a list of sample questions and then started to type out my response just to make sure I was following what's known as the STAR method. And you'll hear a lot about that at business school. So highly suggest looking that up if you're not familiar with it. And from there, I really started to practice. I remember, you know, driving to the gym in the morning and just rehearsing my responses out loud to myself. And then once I got more comfortable with that, I would ask, you know, family members to, you know, mock interview me and get more comfortable that way. Also suggest, you know, since we were having virtual interviews, mine was actually with an alumni, not a second year student. But, you know, practicing over Zoom, if that is the case, or if it's in person, practicing in person, because it really does make a difference. So highly suggest doing that.
Yeah. So I think, you know, everyone here has kind of like echoed a lot of like really, really good high level points. The only thing I would say is that, you know, be it a second year admissions fellow, you're interviewing an alumni in this case, what is a commonality amongst everyone that you've been interviewing with is that, you know, they've gone through the Fuqua experience, right? So I think for me, I really try to express, one, my love of interest in a school and what Team Fuqua, you know, represents to me. Because I think more than anything, you know, that's what really bonds all of us together, be it, you know, you might have graduated 10 years ago or you're still a current second year. So just, you know, obviously like do your research, understand why you want to be here, you know, why the school is a great fit for you. We really want to make sure that, again, it's not like a technical interview. Like Fred said, we just want to have a conversation with you to make sure that you're going to be your most authentic and best version of yourself once you step foot into Durham. And I think, you know, that's one of the best things and advice I've been given. And I really, really enjoyed my interview with my interviewer.
Awesome. I love all of the feedback and advice and suggestions that you all have provided, because you've hit on a lot of things that we talk about as admissions advisors, which is being authentic, right? Having a high level of self-awareness, being able to recognize the strengths, the things you do well, but also how you need to grow and the things that will help you to grow. Being able to identify your place within our community through connecting with current students and alumni, and really being able to have a true understanding of what we mean when we say Team Fuqua. So clearly that's why you all were admitted. You did a fantastic job with that. So kudos to you. Again, I want to thank all of our student panelists for joining us today, as well as for the admissions counselors that hosted the very first session. I do hope that this event was helpful for all of our prospective students who chose to attend today. I hope that you also understand that we really want you to be intentional about this process. That's a key theme. Breaking down each aspect of the application, getting a true understanding of what we're looking for, and being able to present your true, authentic self in the overall application process. So thank you all again. There are a couple of next steps that as an admissions counselor, I want to recommend that you do. The first is to continue to stay connected with our community. There are a number of different virtual information sessions. You can schedule for campus visits later on throughout the year. Take a trip to Durham to also see the city that you may potentially live in for 2 years. I think all of those things are really important. Clearly outline your goals. Have an understanding of why Fuqua, not just why an MBA, but why Fuqua in particular. And putting all those things together, along with having great work experience and a strong academic profile, will ultimately help present you in a very competitive light to the admissions committee. And that's the ultimate goal, is to show that you're going to be a competitive applicant and to be a contributing member to our community and a value add to the overall MBA experience within Fuqua as well. If you have any questions, there are a number of ways for you to get connected to our office. You can call us, you can email us. There are members who are available to talk to you Monday through Friday, every day, who can answer phone calls or respond to emails as well. And then if you're thinking about applying, whether it's early action or a later round, just making sure that you're prepared. Remembering that early action is a binding round. And if you're not quite ready to make that commitment just yet, then maybe not apply in early action, but look at other rounds. Doesn't mean that your interest in Fuqua is not strong, but we want to make sure that you apply in the round that will allow you to submit the most competitive application overall. So again, thank you all so very much for attending the session today. We have a number of virtual events and on-campus events that will allow you to ask more questions. If your questions were not answered in today's session, I invite you to go to the website and register for those as well. Some that are specific to the application process, and some that also just give a general program overview. Each will be a value add for you as you're trying to learn more about us and put the final touches on your application. So again, thank you all for joining us today. Thank you to all the panelists and participants. We hope that this information was helpful to you and that you learned more about our community. And we're excited and look forward to receiving your admissions applications. Thank you all again.